Thank you, Molly, for the introduction, and thank you for the organizer for the invitation. Okay, my presentation. In my presentation, I just want to point out the significant human rights issue raised by the current trends in regulating the online content. In particular, regulation of communication technologies poses several human rights questions, in particular in relation to freedom of expression. We can say that freedom of expression on the internet could be considered the fundamental right of our age. Internet, in fact, could be considered a key instrument for the by which individual can actually exercise the right to freedom of expression and opinion, as guaranteed by several international treaties, as was cited before, by the ICCPR, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, from the European Convention on Human Rights, and also by most national constitutions. In this sense, we can say that digital communication have opened a tremendous new opportunities for realizing the freedom of expression and opinion. In this context, I think it could be interesting to note some of the points highlighted by the Special Rapporteur, United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Promotion and Protection of the Right to Freedom of Expression and Opinion, Frank LaRue. In this report of May 2011, the Special Rapporteur highlighted that the unique and transformative nature of the internet is able to permit to individuals to exercise the right to freedom of opinion and expression, but also a range of other human rights, and to promote, in this sense, the progress of society as a whole. So, in very few words, this is paragraph that I mean, probably the most important paragraph of the report. In very few words, we can say that, according to this report, the freedom of access to this kind of medium has the capability to enable a list of other human rights. For example, we can see that internet could be an instrument for the right to education, to the right to take part in cultural life, to the right of association. So the access to this medium is particularly important. In this framework, in this context, we have to consider the problematic question of the internet content governance. Many states, and in this sense we have no difference between democratic or authoritarian states, have started to control, manipulate, and block sometimes content disseminated through the internet. And obviously, such action are in contrast with the state's obligation under international human rights law, and often create a direct chilling effect on the right to freedom of expression and opinion. There are different forms of restriction of access to the information. States can arbitrarily block or filter the content transmitted to the medium, as it happens in China or in Egypt during the so-called Arab Springs. Again, states can criminalize some form of legitimate expression. A clear example is the criminalization of some activity of bloggers around the world, where we have seen something similar in China, Vietnam, and Iran. And again, states can impose some form of intermediate reliability. Recent trend in this year is the change of the so-called safe harbor rules that we have after a longer period of discussion embedded in the US, for example, in the Communication Decency Act, and in Europe in the European directive on the electronic commerce. And again, states can disconnect users from internet access, on the basis of violation of intellectual property rights. And this happened in Europe, especially with the so-called graduate response regime implemented by the Adopi Law in France, the Digital Economy Act in England, the Sindel Law in Spain, and again. It's interesting to note that in a recent survey conducted by Freedom House, is a study on 47 countries all over the world. Freedom House has tried to measure each country level of internet and digital media freedom, examining obstacles to access, limited on content, or violation of user rights. And it is interesting to note that in this list, there is a sort of evaluation of the freedom of each country. With the green line, we have the list of countries that are considered free, completely free. With the yellow line, we have the list with the countries that are considered partly free, and then on the bottom, the countries that are considered not free. And it's interesting to know that among the countries that are considered partly free, we have also some countries that are considered democratic, like India, Mexico, and Turkey. So this is a problem that, I mean, is not related just to the country that considered not a proper democracy. Again, this framework is interesting to consider the digital content reforms that are recently introduced or discussed in Europe and in the US. We have a list of a quite long list. I just to point out the digital content reform that consider much more important or significant. The SOPA and PIPA in the US, just discussed. The ACTA, the international treaty that was refused in Europe, the Sindel Law in Spain, and again the Adopi Law in France and the Digital Economy Act in UK. I want to take some time to focus on the Adopi Law. And this my interest in this piece of law is connected to the fact that this law was contrary to all the other digital content reform. This law was considered by the National Constitutional Court of France. And so we have an interesting assessment, a sort of previous assessment. In France, the Constitutional Court had the possibility to apply a sort of preliminary assessment after the adoption from the Parliament. Probably no time to enter in the discussion of the constitutional system, but then, anyway, in France, the Constitutional Court has this power to evaluate the constitutionality of a piece of law immediately after the Parliament. And this attention, the point that I want to highlight in this case is directly connected to some contrast of this law with the human rights principle. The main objective of this piece of law was the prevention of illegal copying or distribution over the internet of digital content protected by copyright. And the main provision is the institution of a new independent authority, the ADOPI, that is the acronym of the English High Authority for the Dissemination of Work and Protection of Copyright on the Internet, an independent authority, so with the role of monitor suspected infringers. The part that was considered unconstitutional by the French Conseil Constitutionnel was the part in which the law permitted a sort of penalties applied directly by this independent authority. In the first version of this law, because obviously after the decision of the court, the parliament had tried to recast the text of the law according to the decision of the court. In this first version of the law, the independent authority had the power to impose directly some penalties without any judicial guarantee. And this is the point, the most debated point of the law. In particular, the French Constitutional Court started his judgment with a reference to the Article 11 of the Declaration of the Right of the Man of the Citizen of 1789, that is still part of the constitutional framework of France. And with this reference, the court have tried to demonstrate the central role of internet access for the freedom of expression. And this, in this sense, because of this central role of the medium, the court have considered the access to the medium an important instrument for the realization of these rights. And in this way, have requested a more balanced control on any kind of restriction of this right. On this point, I think it's important to highlight also a misunderstanding that probably most of you have seen on the internet about this law. In fact, most of the bloggers and magazines have tried to interpret this decision as a sort of implicit demonstration that internet access is a fundamental right per se. But this is not the real interpretation of the decision of the court. The court, in fact, does not consider the internet per se a human right. But on the contrary, what said the court is that in a modern world, in a modern society, where internet access is a very important instrument for the freedom of expression and also for a series of other rights. In a modern society, states have a sort of positive obligation to provide the access to network services, or at least a duty to allow it. In this sense, we do not need a new rights. We just need a sort of reinterpretation at the light of the new technological context of rights that are already present in most of the important international treaty or national constitutions. This discussion, I think, could be seen at light of the current IP enforcement agenda. The current IP enforcement agenda is focused essentially on an expansion of intellectual property protection. Sometimes people consider this a sort of over-expansion of intellectual property protection. And in this context, I think that the decision of the French Constitutional Court, but also other decisions of other judges concerning the relationship between the intersection between fundamental rights and IP law, we can see that fundamental rights are more often invoked with increasing frequency in order to rebalance the conflict produced by the expansionary tendency of intellectual property law. Also in respect to good and services crucial to human development. Before we have discussed about the access to medicine, I can say that we can see more or less the same problem with the new phenomenon of the personalized medicine. Also in this case, patents are used in some way to close to create enclosure on public goods like biological information. In some way can be considered a sort of public good. That I mean, if you try to privatize this element, indirectly do not permit people to access to the different kind of medicine that are available. In conclusion, just try to point out some policy suggestions. In order to be in line with the international human rights framework, it would be necessary to clearly determine the legally defined scope, objective, and limitation for controlling online content. And in this way, I think that it should be necessary to put some limits on delegated authority and on measures that could lead to arbitrary decision. It should be necessary to base all the restriction on clear and specific rule, possibly embedded in statute of law. Again, it should be necessary to promote the transparency over any form of internet blocking. And finally, it should be necessary to safeguard the establishment of due process and ex post facto judicial procedure in respect of blocking internet access with the full involvement of the civil society. That's all.